can unfold in the greatest story ever told by you, for I welcome to the human race, the human race.
See, this whole swamp is actually just one tree spread out over miles. Branches spread, then sink and take root, and then spread some more. One big living organism, just like the entire world.
I get how the tree is one big thing, but the whole world?
Sure. You think you're any different from me, or your friends, or this tree? If you listen hard enough, you can hear every living thing breathing together. You can feel everything growing. We're all living together, even if most folks don't act like it. We all have the same roots, and we are all branches of the same tree.
One adventure.
Something's broken, been plated in gold. Unveiled secrets, garnished and old. Can't say, but we can be saved. Come now, let our blood carve the path, the pulse that brings us closer to all our lives, to the breath that keeps us beating. To the breath that keeps us. The breath that keeps us beating.
People all over the world made the difficult transition from nomadic cultures to agricultural ones that used solar energy more efficiently. It gave rise to civilization. We stand on the shoulders of those who did the hard work that such a fundamental transformation required. Now, our turn.
There's more than the patio here.
He just keeps walking. He doesn't know. He's just part of of lots of worlds. And the human race is sort of like that. After they've discovered what's up there, they know they're only a little part of the huge galaxy. I think there probably are many different kinds of life forms, cells and organisms. Some may not be visible, some may not have been discovered, and some may be on places we can't go. And they all might have the same perspective as we do on this, that there might be others, and that maybe they can find them someday, but at the moment,
ladies and gentlemen,
music makers, and we are the dreamers of dreams.
No matter how empty the world seemed, no matter how degraded and used up the world appeared to us, we knew that anything was still possible, and given the right circumstances, a new world was just as likely as an old one.
Thank you.
What we're looking for is how everything works. What makes everything work? It has to do with curiosity. It has to do with people wondering what makes something do something.
There's a way of looking anew, as if you never saw it before, for the first time, and asking questions about it, as if you were different.
And then to discover that if you try to get answers, that they're related to each other. And things that make the wind make the waves. And the motion of water is like the motion of air, is like the motion of sand. Things have common features. Turns out more and more universal. It's almost unbelievable. The truth is so remarkable, so amazing.
It's incredible.
Take the world from another point of view.
It's curiosity. It's the world we are, what we are.
Just like a runner gets a kick out of sweating, I get a kick out of thinking. I can't stop.
Our destiny is in the stars. Remember to look up at the stars and not down at your feet. Try to make sense of what you see, and wonder about what makes the universe exist. Be curious.
Congratulations. You're alive. There's an unbroken thread that stretches across more than 3 billion years that connects us to the first life that ever touched this world. Think of how tough, resourceful, and lucky all of our countless ancestors must have been to survive long enough to pass on the message of life to the next, and the next, and the next generation. Hundreds of millions of times. Before it came to us. There were so many rivers to cross, so many hazards along the way. Predators, starvation, disease, miscalculation, long winters, drought, flood, and violence. Not to mention the occasional upheavals that erupted from within our planet, and the apocalyptic bolts that come from the blue. No matter where we hail from or who our parents were, we are descended from the hardy survivors of unimaginable catastrophes. Each of us is a runner in the longest and most dangerous relay race there ever was. And at this moment, we hold the baton in our hands.
Has the sound of epic myth. And we who embody the local eyes and ears and thoughts and feelings of the cosmos, we've begun at last to wonder about our origins, star stuff, contemplating the stars. Our obligation to survive and flourish is owed not just to ourselves, but also to that cosmos, ancient and vast, from which we spring.
what are these barriers that keep people from reaching anywhere near their real potential? The answer to that can be found in another question, and that's this. Which is the most universal human characteristic? Fear or laziness?
The paradox of our time in history is that we have taller buildings but shorter tempers, wider freeways but narrower viewpoints. We spend more but have less. We buy more but enjoy less. We have bigger houses and smaller families, more conveniences, but less time. We have more degrees, but less sense, more knowledge, but less judgment, more experts, yet more problems. It is a time when there is much in the showroom window and nothing in the stockroom. We've learned how to make a living, but not a life. We've added years to life, but not life to years. We've been all the way to the moon and back, but have trouble crossing the street to meet a new neighbor. We conquered outer space, but not inner space. We've done larger things, but not better things. To truly bring a world out of darkness, we must illuminate the light within ourselves. And you know,
happiness can be found even in the darkest of times, if one only remembers to turn on the light.
Give in and get out, we rise in the dying, we rise in the dying.
There should be no boundary to human endeavor. We are all different. However bad life may seem, there is always something you can do and succeed at. While there is life, there is hope.
Species, an interesting mix. You're capable of such beautiful dreams and such horrible nightmares. You feel so lost, so cut off, so alone. In all our searching, the only thing we've found that makes the emptiness bearable is each other.
And a smile from you might make these blues go away.
I had a friend once who told me that the worst mistake that you can make is to think that you are alive, when really you're asleep in life's waiting room.
See, it took 500 years for someone to notice
something hidden in plain sight. His doctor noticed the shape of the human brain. Message being that the divine gift does not come from a higher power, but from our own mind.
Psychedelic state. This is what we should be looking for. You are an explorer and you represent our species. And the greatest good you can do is to bring back a new idea, because our world is endangered by the absence of good ideas. Our world is in crisis because of the absence of consciousness.
Just pray.
Whatever degree any one of us can bring back a small piece of the picture and contribute it to the building of the new paradigm, then we participate in the redemption of the human spirit. And that, after all, is what it's really all about.
The energy is out there.
Cheer up. You can't blame anyone else for the kind of world you're in. And if you know, you see that I, in the sense of the person, the front, the ego, really doesn't exist, then it won't go to your head too badly if you wake up and discover that you're God.
Spend most of our lives functioning in states of lower consciousness, where what we're principally concerned with is ourselves, our survival, and our own success narrowly defined. Ordinary life rewards practical, unintrospective, self-justifying outlooks that are the hallmarks of lower consciousness. Neuroscientists speak of a lower part of the brain they call the reptilian mind, and tell us that under its sway, we strike back when we're hit, blame others, quell any stray questions that lack immediate relevance, fail to free associate, and stick closely to a flattering image of who we are and where we're headed. However, at rare moments when there are no threats or demands upon us, perhaps late at night or early in the morning, when our bodies and passions are comfortable and quiescent, we have the privilege of being able to access the higher mind, what neuroscientists call our neocortex, the seat of imagination, empathy, and impartial judgment. We loosen our hold on our own egos and ascend to a less biased and more universal perspective, casting off a little of the customary anxious self-justification and brittle pride. In such states, the mind moves beyond its particular self-interests and cravings. We start to think of other people in a more imaginative way. Rather than criticize and attack, we're free to imagine their behavior being driven by pressures derived from their own more primitive minds, which they're generally in no position to tell us about. Their temper or viciousness are, we now see, symptoms of hurt rather than of evil. It's an astonishing gradual evolution to develop the ability to explain others' actions by their distress, rather than simply in terms of how it affects us. We perceive that the appropriate response to humanity is not fear, cynicism, or aggression, but always, when we can manage it, love. At such moments, the world reveals itself as quite different, a place of suffering and misguided effort, full of people striving to be heard and lashing out against others, but also a place of tenderness and longing, beauty in touching vulnerability. The fitting response is universal sympathy and kindness. One's own life feels less precious.
I want human be human again.
I want human be human again.
Every human being is actually a mere cell in a single superorganism that is humanity. And therefore, if each one of us is part of a larger whole, then altruism and beneficence and charity are in our own self-interest. The simplistic divide of right and wrong and good and evil in superhero comics suddenly seems less silly because our morals aren't arbitrary social constructs. They're the genetic programming instructing this superorganism not to destroy itself.
Fulfilled his quest for immortality. We still read the Epic of Gilgamesh, and with every reader, he lives again. And all those heroes and superheroes who have come since follow in the footsteps of the first hero's journey. Another kind of immortality, a story sent from one civilization to another across thousands of years.
About the human condition. You aren't just a screen name or a series of numbers, you are a member of the human family. And although we may only be an advanced breed of monkey living on a small planet, we are able to contemplate the universe as a whole, and that makes us very special. Our species has cured diseases, charted the globe, walked the moon, discovered fire and electricity, and passed the message of life all the way down to you. thousand generations live within you, and human knowledge is cumulative, which means you are much an integral part of human history as you are a product of it. There are many endings to our story. It is what we do with the gift of consciousness that determines who we are and what will become of our species. We are the custodians of life's meaning. If we crave some cosmic purpose, then let us find a worthy goal. Because life is more than working, coming home, and closing the door behind you. It is up to each of us to discover our potential, harness it, and bring positive change to the world. Because despite all of our failings and fallibilities, we humans are capable of greatness. The next stage in the evolution of human consciousness is upon us. And if it is not us who usher it in, it will be a species very like us, but with more of our strengths and fewer of our weaknesses. They will look back and marvel at how vulnerable our tiny planet once was. How perilous our infancy. How humble our beginnings.
How many rivers we had to cross before we found our way.